You're watching WHPS, Highland Park, Detroit.
WGPR Detroit, HD2.
The views and opinions expressed on the following show are not necessarily the views and opinions of WHPS, its affiliates, management, or sponsors.
It's the These Nuts Show with your host, Butter, and friends. Butter here, magician escape artist, practicing for my show tonight. Come on in, have a seat. Seconds, you gotta be enough to get out of this one. Twist, a little turn, ta-da! It's showtime! It's your old friend Butter here. I may be a nut, but I know to wear my mask. Please welcome my first guest tonight, fitness guru, Wally Walnut.
Our Wally Walnut here to tell you to wash your hands with soap and water for 20 seconds so you will stay healthy and strong like me.
Almond Cruz here, sliding in with the news. Distance is what we must do to stay away from the chew and other germs in the air that might be trying to get on you. Social distancing is a wonderful way to see friends. As long as you're 6 feet apart, you win.
Hey there, friends. I wouldn't miss this for the world. It's me, Pumpkin Spice, your healthy girl. Remember, it's important to use your kind hearts and follow the signs to stay healthy and safe at all times.
Chica Chumitsky here to say, don't forget the little ones that need you to lead the way. That's how we remember to wash our hands, mask, and social distance today.
Morgan Raisin, yes, it's me, here to sing about health and safety. We are all here to help get a message out to your grapevine, teaching healthy choices to stay safe all the time.
Don't let these guys drive you nuts. Put your mask on first, they'll let you be. And it keeps me safe from the...
chew!
That's trying to get on me.
Butter me up, she's right, you know. Thank you, Hallie Cranberry, for joining the show. Let's all be nuts about our health. Social distancing, wash your hands frequently, use hand sanitizer, and wear a mask. Practice what we learned to stay away from the chew germ. We're all in this together. Coming soon, the mini adventures of These Nuts in a theater near you.
Feedback. Hi, this is Theo Broton.
And I am the BDM Pina.
Inviting you to join us each Monday at 9 a.m. for Feedback,
a positive image production by Hood Research.
Encourage others to tune in each Monday on
Comcast Detroit, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, watch WHPR TV Network anywhere.
And take us along with you. Feedback.
Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you this Monday. My name is the BD. I'll be your host. We'll have a variety of guests and topics. Today, I want to give shout outs to Theo. She's not going to be here today. Also, to some of our other listeners and viewers who are just part of the family, that's Professor Griggs, Brother James Ford, Sly Soul, Brother Keith Hines, and many others of you. And as always, I ask you to have pen and paper handy because, and as I demonstrate as well, as you know, have pen and paper handy because sometimes there's information you may want to record and it just doesn't set with you, it doesn't stay with your mind. So I want to ask you all to do that. I also want to announce, because we're approaching primary, and my first guest will be discussing that, we're approaching the primary, so I'm hoping that you all have your absentee ballots or you're ready to go to the ballot box because it's critical that we become a part of the system that we are a part of. Sometimes we just kind of let things happen and we don't participate as we should. But I think that it's very critical that we become a part of it because whether we want to acknowledge it or not, the system is going to work whether we're part of it or not, and we will be affected by the decisions of the system. So without, as they say, further ado, I want to introduce one of my guests today, Mr. Walter Epps, who is a candidate for Wayne County Sheriff. And I want to thank you and welcome you to the program, brother.
Thanks, brother. Glad to be here.
Yes. Now, the first thing I want to ask our guest is, who is Walter Epps?
Well, so my name is Walter Epps, and I'm a candidate for Wayne County Sheriff this August 2nd primary. And I was real quick. I was born and raised in the city of Detroit. All my education in the city of Detroit. I graduated from Northwestern High School. I did my first year at Wayne State, and I shipped off to the United States Navy. Spent a little time in the Navy, came back home, and I started with the Sheriff's Department shortly thereafter. At 22 and a half years old, worked my way up the ranks through executive lieutenant. Had a real good time with the Sheriff's Department, real fruitful career, I should say. Retired in 2010, and in that year I ran against the late, great Benny Napoleon, God rest his soul. And today, I work with the City of Detroit. Yeah, I work with the City of Detroit as a finance professional. I work under the Office of the Chief Financial Officer, and I am currently in the United States Navy. I am a supply officer in the Navy at the rank of Lieutenant Commander, and I have a total of a little over 28 years with the Navy.
Okay, yeah. Wonderful, wonderful. You know, I'm interested when you say financial officer. I want to know, does the Wayne County Sheriff himself, okay, you have a budget or they have a budget.
Yes.
Now, does the Wayne County Sheriff administer that budget, and then how or what is the process of that? I guess it's the disbursement of funds, but how does that work in terms of the Wayne County Sheriff and the budget that he's given to work with?
So the budget, and particularly the budget for the Sheriff's Office, is for our jails, our courts, and parks. That's our primary responsibilities. So once the, between the commission and the county exec, once they determine what that budget will be, the amount, you know, they issue it. And yes, it is up the sheriff's responsibility to ultimately make sure that those funds are spent accordingly, right, and appropriately.
Right. Now, one of the things that I'm interested in now, mm-hmm. I believe recently, let's say within the last year, I know there was a Wayne County sheriff that lost his life due to some improprieties, let's say, within the system. Mm-hmm. Now, what will you bring to the system to, let's say, bolster it, make it better? What are your ideas or visions about how Wayne County Sheriff Department should work?
You know what? And that was a very unfortunate incident. The problem is right now that the Sheriff Department is very short on officers, very low, right? And there's about a little over 300 budgeted positions that they're missing. So we have to get those positions filled, right? Get those positions filled, fill those vacancies, because right now, in that particular situation, the officer was actually working as a double time. He was on his 16 hours, right at the end of his 16 hours. Mm-hmm. So it's a long day, right? And short staff. So the staffing just wasn't there. So what I would do different is we have to fill those gaps. We got to get young men and women to understand that law enforcement is a viable career. That we have a public service of responsibility, and their contribution matters. I think once we do that, once we get men and women to understand that law enforcement is a viable career, I think we can attract attention. But once we do that, once we fill those voids, we can go a long way. We can make things happen.
Now, I want to indicate to the viewers that the call-in numbers were at the bottom of the screen, and which is one reason why I ask you to have pen and paper handy, because I'll be honest with you, my memory, once you start adding things to your memory, you just start moving things back. It's like adding another page every day. You tend to say, well, what was on page 20 when you're on page 30? So I ask you to do that for your benefit as well. Now, I've sort of observed the Wayne County. I look at law enforcement in mm-hmm. general. Now, you know, there's an issue between any law enforcement now, it seems, and the community, particularly communities of color. So is there anything that you would do to address what it is, I would say, is the divide or the gap between the relationship, because without relationship, when I grew up, we visited a police station. We're talking 60s now, okay? Mm-hmm. A whole different era. But we were able to interact with the police a lot better then than now. So what would you do in your position as sheriff to kind of help, let's say, build a better relationship between the community and have them, as you say, we want young people to know that this is a viable career, but what would you do to encourage them, number one, and then to establish a better relationship with the community in general?
So that's like one of the most important tasks right now, because law enforcement in general around the United States has a black eye on it, right? It's our citizens against law enforcement. So we have to fix that, right? And not just with the sheriff department. It starts with the sheriff department, but all over Wayne County, right? Starting with Wayne County, there's 43 communities in Wayne County. And I always add Wayne State in there because they have a nice police force, and they contribute as well. So with all of our law enforcement agencies, my goal and my plan is on my website. You can see my website, my plan, at walterepsforsheriff.com. And everything that we're talking about here is right on my website. But my goal, and I started with the other law enforcement agencies, is to bridge, is for us to come together, right, as a group, law enforcement agencies, even including the state police and at the federal level, right? People have to trust police. So once we come together, and then we integrate with our communities, all communities in Wayne County. But in the sheriff's department, particularly, what I would like to do is bring that ethnicity, that diversity training, right? I want to start with the officers. And as we hire them, as they come in, right, start officers off understanding that it's not the police responsibility to lock folks up, to arrest folks, but it is our responsibility to make our communities safe, right? To work with our communities. I think that's the start. When we work with people, when we get young men and women fresh into the department and they learn a certain way, then they'll behave a certain way.
Okay, I want to ask the caller just to hold on, because I believe you're calling for a particular thing, the plowshares. Now we're going to spend maybe another 5 minutes, but what I want to do is ask you to let the public know, what is the jurisdiction of the Wayne County Sheriff's? Because a lot of people think when they see a police officer, they can automatically hail them, but state police have a jurisdiction, local police have jurisdictions, as well as the Wayne County Sheriff. So if you would share with the public, what is the jurisdiction and responsibility of Wayne County Sheriff's?
Okay, and that's a good question, because a lot of people just don't know, right? And there's really three levels of local law enforcement: state police, county sheriff, and then city police, right? And particularly here in Southeast Michigan, the state police, their responsibility is the highways, right? But you do see them doing a lot more, right? You see them on the streets in our communities, interacting with citizens. So they've brought in their responsibility. The city police with Detroit, right, for example, and there's 43 communities in Wayne County, and each community has its own law enforcement agency, like Highland Park here. They're responsible for the law enforcement in those communities, right? So they're budgeted to do law enforcement in their own communities. The sheriff's department, right, our primary functions with the sheriff's department is the jails, the courts, and the parks. That's what we're budgeted, that's what we're mandated to do. But a sheriff such as myself, what I would like to do, right, and you'll see that in 83 counties in the state of Michigan, there's 83 counties, and sheriffs, while we make it our goal to perfect those responsibilities, we also want a presence out in our community. We want to assist local law enforcement agencies in a supporting manner. So that's our goal. That's what we do. But the jurisdiction for Wayne County, the sheriffs, is in all of Wayne County, 43 communities.
You know, I think it's important for us to know that as people, because, again, as you say, and myself, I admit, I'm in the same position, too. If you're in need, you think law enforcement, you know, you think that I can call this person. I know that I've participated in the Wayne County Park Systems, you know, just as holding one of the I guess what they call one of the passes where you can get into any one of the metro parks, which would be part of your jurisdiction, I would think, right? Or at least within Wayne County, because So I think it's important for us to know. Now, what I want you to do, is there a telephone number, or would you just advise people to go to your website? And then again, I would like you to spell that out for them too, because you know we have, you know, like Epps. I don't, you know, people might have their own way of spelling.
Yes.
So I want them to have a detailed way of in being able to contact you and support your quest yes. for Wayne County Sheriff.
Yes, and I appreciate that. So the best way to contact me and my team is through my website. You'll find our numbers there. But let me start with the telephone. The telephone number to directly contact us is 313-330-4949.
Now, is that for texting?
I'm sorry. 313-330-4984.
84.
There we go. 84.
We're going to give it to him one more time. 313-330-4984.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then your website?
And the website is my first and last name, Walter Epps. ForSheriff.com, and that's Walter, Walter, Epps, Epps, For Sheriff, and that's For Sheriff. And it's spelled just like Mike Epps.
Yeah, yeah, and many of you know Mike Epps, and we try to do that because we want people to be able to, you know, I've done, you know, I'll put it like this, I'm an elder when it comes to my children and my granddaughter, so therefore sometimes it's harder for us to be able to grasp some of the technology that is constantly evolving. And this is just something that I want you all to be able to do. And I think it's important to reach out. Now, as Mr. Epps said, August 2nd is the primary. There are many avenues that you can take to make sure that you're part of the system. So what I would advise you to do is you can contact your city clerk, Janice Winfrey, contact that office. You can go to certain polling sites. The ones that I'm familiar with mostly are Wayne County Community College, whether it's the Northwest Campus on Outer Drive, the Eastern Campus on Connor, or the downtown campus on Fort Street, mm-hmm. Which is near the main post office. We always try to give landmarks as references. So you can go there and vote the same day, get your absentee ballot and vote the same day. But it's critical that you vote. And I would tell you to look at Mr. Epps' website, because it's always good to be knowledgeable about what you're doing. And I want to again thank you and let you repeat that information once more, and then we'll go to a break about how people can contact you so that way you can become involved, because whether you agree or disagree, you are a part of the system, and to sit back and complain about the system is not the way to change the system.
Every vote matters. Thank you. And again, to reach me and my campaign and to see my plan, right, to see our plan, our future plans for Wayne County Sheriff's Department, WalterEppsForSheriff.com, and then you can always call us at 313-330-4984.
And I want to thank you, Mr. Epps, for being a part of the program. And I hope that this encourages you also, all of you who are listening. And not only that, but share with your family, friends, neighbors, church members, whoever you have in your circle. Please share that information with them so that they can become involved too. If you have teenagers who are 18 or over, let them become a part of the system, because we don't want to be in the system. We want to be a part of the system. So I want to thank you again, Mr. Epps. We're going to go to a break, and I'll see you guys at the poll August 2nd.
Awesome. Thank you.
It's time to do something more. Join the Detroit Police Department, either straight out of high school or make a bold career change. Officers start at $40,000, plus health insurance, paid vacation, retirement plans, and more. Apply online at joindetroitblue.org.
Let's savor these moments, made possible by the COVID-19 vaccine. Dining out going by keeping yourself protected and your COVID-19 vaccines up to date.
Hi, This is LaWanda.
This is RJ Watkins.
Coming to you to bring you some information about the number one detox in the nation, Lemon Burn. Lemon Burn helps to turn the fat into fit. It's for you, a happier, healthier you. Because you know healthy is the new beautiful. An all-natural way to improve your health. It promotes a healthy digestive system, attacks and reduces belly fat, as well as gives you energy. And to get yours today, call 313-868-6612.
Don't forget to exercise and eat right.
Feedback. Hi, this is Theo Brota.
And I am the BDM Pina.
Inviting you to join us each Monday at 9 a.m. for Feedback,
a positive image production by Hood Research.
Encourage others to tune in each Monday on
Comcast Detroit, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, watch WHPR TV Network anywhere.
And take us along with you. Feedback.
Hello, I want to welcome you back. Again, my name is Thabiti. Many of you know me as the co-host with Theo, who's unable to be with us today because of other responsibilities. So you have me rolling in the captain's chair. I'm your pilot for today. And we welcome everyone who is listening and viewing, and hope that we can bring something to you. As you know, the motto of Hood Research is people would do better if they knew better. And it's our position to take this platform, which we thank WHPR, WHPS, RJ Watkins, Henry Tyler, Flip, my engineer, and others. We use this platform to disseminate information that we hope will help to make your life better. Hello, caller. Are you on the air? Okay, we're working this situation out. But what I want to say in the meantime, and let the engineer know, we do have someone at the front door, other guests as well. Okay, we're going to try another thing here. Hello, caller. Can you hear me? Hello, caller. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Oh, Brother Keith Hines.
Hey, what's up, Kabidi?
How are you, sir? How are you doing?
Oh, I'm okay. How are you and Theo doing?
Very good. I'm rolling solo today. I'm in the hot seat, so to speak, and Theo has other things that she has to do. Let me put you on hold because I have another caller who I think is our guest. So I want to put you on hold, lock you in, and then go straight to our guest.
Okay, sounds like a winner.
Hello, caller. You're on the air. Would you give us your name and how you're viewing us? Hello, caller. Can you hear me? Okay, I'm working these buttons out. Now, I will admit to anyone, I am technically challenged. That's how it is with seniors. Hello, caller. Can you hear me?
Yes, hello. How are you?
Very good. And would you give us your name, sir?
Yeah, my name is John Sloan.
Oh, thanks for calling, Mr. Sloan. I'm Thabiti. Mark Cummings has introduced you to me. So what I'd like to do is first ask you, who is John Sloan, and then we can speak about the Hastings Streets production.
Sure, thank you. So, you know, I grew up basically in Oak Park and attended the University of Michigan for musical theater. And I lived, after school, I moved to New York. I was in L.A. for a little while. And I moved back home in 2017 to Detroit. And, you know, I run a theater company called Ghostlight Productions. I'm a writer. I'm an actor. I'm a musician. I'm an activist. And I am, you know, right now really excited because I am one of the co-writers of the musical Hastings Street, which is going up at the Music Hall.
Okay, now, I grew up in an area called Black Bottom, which I guess is like the sister of Hastings Street. So give us an overview of Hastings Street, the production. What will the audience, should the audience expect? And then we can get into contact information, websites, and those type of things. But give us an overview of what is the Hastings Streets production that you're a part of now.
Yeah, so this is a new musical that was commissioned by Plowshares Theater Company. And I wrote it. I wrote the script, and I co-wrote the music and lyrics with a wonderful artist named Chris Johnson. And this show follows one family. It follows the Carson family, a fictitious family that lives in Detroit, through this tumult and change. So it's in 49, right after the new Housing Act was passed.
And it's this family as they deal with the changes in the community, as they grapple with family changes and dynamics, and how they all as a unit, both the family and the community, pull together to try to figure out, you know, how to beat back this gentrification and the erasure of their neighborhood.
You know, I find that very interesting, and particularly when you speak of gentrification, because as it was then, it is now. Many of us know that our neighborhoods are being, let's just say, repopulated with other communities outside of ourselves. And
aggressively, so
we're kind of, yeah. Aggressively, yes, definitely, and we're being moved to the side. So I like the whole social and political insight of that, because, and I'm encouraging people also to become a part of and view your play, because sometimes when we are communicating to our people, it's important. Well, I put it this way. It seems like we have to use entertainment in many cases to kind of deliver a message where just speaking to them doesn't work. And I'll use music as an example, particularly in the 60s when there was a lot of activism. We had people who were, let's just say, artists, Edwin Starr, War, What's Going On, Marvin Gaye. But we had to use those platforms in order to deliver our message, because trying to speak didn't really work. So I applaud you for that, because I'm an activist myself, and what I like to do is find the easiest way to convey a message that people will be able to grasp, rather than, you know, as it's been said, we don't read books like we should, we right. don't become engaged as we should. So now when you speak about the gentrification of the family, I guess this also deals with that freeway 375 that kind of came through and destroyed everything?
Yeah, it does. And I have to apologize to you. I'm on my way to a conference, so if it's loud in the background, that's why. But, you know, what we really wanted to do with this piece is we wanted to create a piece that also avoided re-traumatizing and triggering the community. And so it starts off, the play is takes place in 49, kind of right as everything is just starting to happen, and right, and obviously before 375 came through. But what we talk about is that none of this happens in a vacuum, right? Things don't happen by accident. And this type of manipulation, this type of cultural erasure, the attempted cultural erasure, was all intentional. And so we really start dealing with the precursor to what did it look like in 48 and 49 for families to be pushed out? What did it look like in 48 and 49 for the city to start offering people, you know, a really pitiful amount of money for their land and force them out of their homes with that intent to eliminate a community for the benefit of others? And so that's really where the musical takes place. I also want to say it's not hopefully a depressing show. There's a lot of amazing music in it. There's a lot of humor in it. There's a lot of community in it. It's a amazing score that is filled with jazz and blues and musical theater. And it's really, if you love music, if you love dance, it's an enjoyable show to go see.
Okay. Now, how much time do you have, sir? Because we're at the bottom of the hour and we have to take our station ID break. But if I can hold you over for a few minutes after that, because I want to get details on how people can get tickets, contact you, and become a part of it. So if you're able to stay with us, we're going to take our bottom of the hour break, and then we'll return right after the break.
You know, I would love to. I have to walk into a conference right now. I have to speak.
Okay.
But I can leave my information with you, and we can call back maybe, because I know you guys are on until about 10:30, right?
Yes.
Okay, why don't I call you back, and we can continue this conversation in depth,
okay.
Right, so it's not rushed.
Look forward to it, and thank you, Mr. Sloan.
Of course. Thank you, sir. Talk soon.
And we want to ask you all to stay tuned. We're getting ready to take our bottom of the hour break, as you know, and we will be back, and we have Brother Keith Hines on the line as well, part of the Tuskegee Coleman A. Young Municipal Airport, International Airport. So stay tuned. Get your pen and paper handy. We'll be right back.
Feedback.
Hi, this is Theo Broughton.
And I am the BDM Pinda.
Inviting you to join us each Monday at 9 a.m. for Feedback.
A positive image production by Hood Research.
Encourage others to tune in each Monday on
Comcast Detroit, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, watch WHPR TV Network anywhere.
And take us along with you.
Feedback. Feedback.
Welcome back. Yes, this is Feedback. I am your host today, the BDM Pinda, and I want to welcome you to the program. And on the line we have Keith Hines, who is a part of so many things. First, hello, Keith.
Yes, still here.
Yeah. What I want to do is tell you to ask you to introduce yourself to the audience and let everyone know who is Keith Hines, because you wear so many hats. I just think people should know, and especially our new listeners and viewers.
Well, my name is Keith Hines, Damage Production. I am also a Tuskegee Airman. And let me see, Aggressive Surge, Free Detroit, We People, Justin Chalmers, Citizen District Council, and I could go on and on. I'm also a 1973 graduate of Aero Mechanic, which we know now as Davis Aerospace, and retired IBEW, which is International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 58. And you know about that.
I guess as they say, for full disclosure, Mr. Keith Hines, Brother Keith Hines, and myself are both retired members of IBEW Local 58, and which is where we met each other. And the wonderful thing about this brother is that he has remained active, as I do, and as I think all of us should. You know, in retirement or even before retirement, we need to do and have quality things that we are pursuing in our life. The upcoming August 2nd, primary is one case in point. So now I want to ask you, Keith, is there anything you can tell us about what's going on in terms of the aerospace, what's maybe happening at the Coleman A. Young International Airport? And I know that they have meetings there, I believe, once a week. So if you could just kind of give us an idea of those kind of things that are going on, because we need people to know and then become involved.
Well, there's so many things. I'm also part of the Davis Aerospace Technical Advisory Committee. And we're really working hard to get the school back to the airport. And we are making progress. There are planes taking off in and out of the airport all the time, every day. It's just that they're commercial and private, but they're not passenger. You know, when I say passenger, I'm talking about a huge passenger. You know, you might have a private jet that lands, can has 30 people on it. But, you know, of course, we don't have the 727 coming in and out of there yet. No major airline.
And I know that from at least what I've heard, my experience, that there are celebrities who will use the Coleman A. Young International Airport as opposed to using Metropolitan Airport, Bishop, and some of the other airports, because it's a lot more convenient. It's a lot, how can I put it? You don't have to deal with as much pedestrian traffic in terms of people who are going all over the country as well as all over the world. So it becomes a very convenient place for people who need to get into Detroit and get out of Detroit and not have to deal with being in a major airport where there's a lot of other things going on. So I'm addressing, I guess, mainly what you're saying in terms of commercial in general, but it's on a smaller level, and private airplanes as well. Now, you were saying that there's an effort being made to have the Davis Aerospace return back to the airport that it was originally. How would you characterize or say the progress of that is going now? And is there anything the public can do?
Well, we've managed to, you know, after they removed the school and relocated it to, Golightly Tech Center over here on the east side on Jefferson. And of course, it didn't meet the standards required by the FAA. We've been able to secure the avionics in the new building that we had put up. Actually, I get to give a lot of credit to Ms. Beverly Kendall Walker, because she's the one from start to finish She's like queen of aviation in Detroit. Because all her life, from the 70s, when she was put in that position at the Friends of Detroit City Airport by Colmenia, she has held it ever since.
Yeah, and I want to give a shout out to Sister Beverly Kendall Walker, who is also a candidate. And I want you all, maybe you can give us a little bit of detail about what she's running for. And again, August 2nd primary is coming, people, and we really need you to become involved in the city and in the county and the state that you live in, because you live here and these policies are made by politicians and they will affect you one way or the other. So give us a little rundown on Beverly Kendall Walker, what she, as you say, she's been a part of the Coleman A. Young International Airport since the 70s, and so her longevity and her community involvement and activism has been there. But give us an overview of her and what her goals are at this point.
Well, Beverly Kendall Walker is a person for the people. Always has been. You know, she can, what is it, like dedication, fairness, integrity, trust, vigilance. That's Beverly Kendall Walker. You know, and she's running for the office of Wayne County Executive, which, of course, we have a person in there now that a lot of people don't really have a lot of confidence in. And Beverly Kendall Walker has a proven track record of having been for the people.
And I want people to know, as you said, she has a resume and a track record. One of the things I try to emphasize all the time to you viewers and listeners is that we see people who pop up during the time of elections, or people who are incumbents who haven't done anything during their time in office, but when election time comes, they want to grab the spotlight, take photo ops and those kind of things. So their track record is shaky if they have one at all. And Beverly Kendall Walker has been involved in this for the long haul. She has always been a part of the community and a voice for the community. And I think as a community, we need to have our voices heard as well. That's one of the things I think is kind of unfortunate, is that when election time comes, and keep in mind, this is the midterm, so there's not all the balloons and the hullabaloo about a presidential election, which even within my circle, particularly family, people tend to win the presidential. But as I indicate all the time, the president has to deal with national and international issues. We have to elect people who deal with local issues, the issues that affect us. And we can't play the role of spectator. We have to be a participator. Voting doesn't take that much time. I always say that there's 365 days out of the year. All we're asking you for is 2 days and only an hour or so of those days. So the primary, August 2nd, which you can still vote ahead of time, as I indicated earlier, the Wayne County campuses, which are located in Detroit, the Eastern Campus on Connor, the Western Campus or Northwest Campus, as it is, on Outer Drive near the Southfield Freeway, and the downtown campus on Fort Street, are all places where you can go and you can basically vote the same day. Now, you can also contact your the Detroit Election Commission office on West Grand Boulevard. But whatever it takes, just do it. It's not that much of your time. It's not that much of your day. And we can win when we fight. If we don't fight, then we can't win. And then we just have to accept, unfortunately, whatever comes our way. So I want to encourage you all to become a part of the system that is already a part of you. Now, Brother Keith, another thing I wanted to ask you, let me preface it by saying this. As many of you know, there have been so many flight cancellations and delays and such that have come on as a result of, let's say, just at the onset of the pandemic. So even my daughter, who was coming back in town recently, she had a flight delay, then a cancellation and delay. And I say that to say that there are so many opportunities now in the air pilot's position. There's just so many positions. I believe there's maybe even 50 to 100,000 positions that are available. And I have seen different things that show that there are, I don't want to say begrudgingly, but let's just say that there are some attempts to involve so-called quote-unquote minorities in it. But Keith, if you could give us an idea of the opportunities within the airline industry, different positions, including pilot, but the other positions, because many people only think of the airline industry as pilots, but there's so many other things. So if you could give us an overview of the different positions, and you had mentioned avionics as well, that people in our community can become a part of and have a lucrative career as well.
Well, it's easy. The aviation industry is actually larger than the automobile industry. People don't realize that. For every plane you see up there, there's a ground crew that keeps that plane in the sky. You know, for every terminal you go into, there are people that keep that terminal operational. Somebody has to build those airplanes. Someone has to maintain those airplanes. Someone has to create and engineer the technology for those airplanes. You know, it's where most people just think about pilots. But I went to school, air mechanics, back, it was called back then, now Davis Aerospace, to be an aircraft mechanic. Because they aviation technology back then, believe it or not, even though people didn't know about it, the school existed since 1943. It was created during the war so that some of the planes that they were building, you know, they built bombers and other aircraft.
Right.
If they had issues, they fix them on the spot. They fly them, land them, get port, repair them, put them back in the sky. You know, you have the person, the clerk that you see when you walk to the administration, you know, when you go to board your plane, you have the person that keeps the plane clean, which is housekeeping. You know, and a lot of us do housekeeping. Those are jobs. You have the electricians, you have the plumbers, you have the carpenters, you have the window cleaners, you have the person that keeps the plane fueled. That's a job in itself right there.
Yeah.
I think that pays about $40,000. And all you have to do is fuel the plane.
You know, I'm going to ask you to I'm going to make a comment and then ask you to get into avionics as well. But one of the things I want people to understand is, like, there are, as Keith indicated, a lot of behind-the-scenes positions. And the airline industry is a very robust industry. In other words, it's not going anywhere. People have to travel, and they have to have qualified people in every position that Keith mentioned, and in other positions as well. And as he and I both know, if you have everybody's not going to go to college. Everybody doesn't have academic inclinations, but we all have potential. And some of our potential can be served in what people would call blue collar, but blue collar has paid very well. We can both attest to that. If you have a skill, now let's say as auto mechanics, for instance, just use that as an example. There are, you know, millions and millions of cars on the road, tens of millions, hundreds of millions more than likely, that are on the road. You have to have people to maintain them. And I say that to say that you don't have to have a degree in order to make an excellent living. And there's something about a skilled trade, whether it's in the construction industry, the airline industry, and other industries. If you have a skilled trade, you pretty much are guaranteed a job for life. There's very little layoff, if at all, within these industries. And we are underrepresented as a people. Now, some of it's because, obviously, the information is not given to us for various reasons, and many of us know what those reasons are, institutional reasons, I'll put it like that. And then sometimes we're just not exposed to those type of things. And again, that becomes a handicap to us which is why we have platforms like this in order to be able to share. Now, there are youth that are graduating from high school every day, and some of them don't have the vision or maybe the guidance or mentorship that would lead them into some of these other industries. But it's very critical that we are able to sustain ourselves. I mean, this is very critical that we have a skill set that we are able to sustain ourselves. And I would encourage all of you to do a little more investigating. I look at social media, and you know, there are people who got recipes and they're doing all kind of things. And I mean, the platform is there for people to use it for whatever purpose they need. But I think that we should also, as a people, take advantage of some of the learning opportunities there as well. Entertainment is fine in its place and in its space, but I think in general what we need is to have some educational input as well. And there's a lot of things that I'll probably mention on the second half of the after 10 o'clock break. I'll mention that. But if you would, Keith, give us an idea of what avionics is, and what it can do for an individual who is skilled in that area.
Well, avionics is around us all the time. We just don't realize. And I want to say, too, anyone can Google aviation jobs, and so much will come up, and you'll say, I don't believe it, because you see all these job openings available today. Right. Just Google aviation jobs. But back to avionics. Now, when I was in high school back in the 70s, I graduated in 1973. I was always telling people I wanted to be an aviation maintenance technician specializing in avionics. And they would look at me like I was crazy, because avionics wasn't a term that was used in the community then. It was alive and real in the aviation industry, but not to us. You know, I was supposed to go to Cass 10. I was supposed to go to Kettering High School if I wanted to play football. I had a full scholarship if I had gone to Kettering. But I chose to go to Airman. Now, avionics, you got your cell phone in your hand. That would not work, or it wouldn't even exist without avionics. That satellite up there that's transferring the signal, avionics. Your television would not be able to operate without avionics. Avionics is the aviation tag for electronics associated with aviation.
Now, one of the things I want to indicate to people as well, when Keith mentions these things about our televisions, our phones and such, I remember, and as we know, we have had so many different inventors, people who came up with ideas. So we can look at Garrett Morgan. The list is endless of the things that we have done in terms of actually creating things. And some of us, like Lewis Latimer, started tinkering with things, you know, like the curiosity of how does this thing work, which the quote that I'm very fond of by Eleanor Roosevelt says, if you could wish any gift for your child, wish them the gift of curiosity. Curiosity is what leads us to discovery, and then that discovery can lead to the creation of so many things. So the idea of satellites, the telephones that we use, the cell phones, computers, etc., all have a foothold or a basis in avionics. And for us to know, one of the things I will say, and I want you to encourage your children at the earliest age that they can understand language, to be better readers, to also become involved in expose them to different things. I would say like the Museum of African American History. Let them become involved in things that will challenge their thinking. One of the things we don't do is sometimes we can get and become part of a rut. And not just our community, but all communities. There's a dumbing down in this country where people are less aggressive when it comes to learning. They'd rather be told something. And the problem with being told something, you don't know whether it's true or not. So we end up suffering as a result of passing on information that we heard, but we can't verify it. And then when we discover that maybe the information was incorrect, then that, you know, sends us in a whole nother direction. I always feel that it's important to learn, to research. That's what Hood Research does. We learn, we have researchers, we share information, we dissect, put it together, and then when we come to you, we hope to be able to enlighten you about things that are going on as well. Now, I know that, as you say, Keith, at present, they're at Go Lightly, I believe, with some of the training.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Go Lightly.
Yeah, they are right. Now, this is, does this start, I'm not really sure. I know when we were in school, it was elementary school, junior high school, and high school. Now they got middle school, you know. I don't know why all this terminology had to change, new math. And
well, they had to get complicated on it.
Yeah, it has made things complicated, and it makes it harder for the elders to teach the youth because they're coming up with new math as if adding, subtraction, multiplication, and division wasn't sound enough, and it worked for us as well. Now they are forced to, and I've been around people who are administrators who say that they are told by their superiors, look, we got to come up with something. So they're trying to reinvent the wheel, but the wheel's working well as it is. So we've got a challenge in that as well. But now at Go Lightly, they're able to take students, I guess, from the fundamentals up to the basics. And what would a student have or know by the time they graduated from Go Lightly?
Well, Go Lightly is a high school. Well, Davis Aerospace is the high school. Go Lightly with a vocational technical center.
Okay.
But Davis Aerospace, a child can go through, it's a high school, and graduate with a pilot's license. And not just the pilot's license, but the education in aviation and the skills to excel in aviation. And that could be the technical, it could be the moral, mechanical. He wanted to be an aircraft mechanic. And there's also airframe that actually teach him all the metalworking skills, electronics. The aviation industry is so complex and simple at the same time because it's all around them. It's just that the FAA has a higher standard than the regular SAE, Society of Automotive and Engineers, you know, but it's here. I graduated. I didn't go directly into aviation. I went to the IBEW, International Brotherhood of Electrical Worker. I got into the apprenticeship program overqualified based on the skills that I learned in high school. I could weld better than the instructor who was supposed to be teaching me how to weld.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I had the same instructor. I think you were in there before myself, but the instructor we had for welding, we had a student in the class who was a welder also, and he ended up teaching us what the instructor didn't. Now, do they teach or have any of the classes that were at Davis Aerospace at Go Lightly?
Well, it's kind of reduced a little bit, so we don't have all of the classes that were included in the original, but it's still on the level of AVA, and definitely when you come out, you're going to be sought by a whole lot of industries, and definitely the military.
Now, you know, that makes me curious, too, because I remember, and I'm far removed from my high school days and junior high, for that matter, how there were a lot of students who were involved in ROTC at the time, Reserve Officers Training Corp, I believe. But the thing is that we had those programs in school along with so many other vocational things that were in-house. We didn't have to be bused to different schools in order to be able to, let's say, apply ourselves on mechanical and inventive levels or creative levels, because it was all in-house. So as I recall, I had metal shop, wood shop, I had commercial foods, learned how to make, excuse me, French toast, typing. I just had a lot of different other options. Piano, I was at Martin Luther King, Go Crusaders. So I had a lot of other opportunities to expand my curious mind. And those are the things that I think helped to set the foundation for me. Number one, to be curious, but also to be able to look at the world in a whole different light. And that's one of the things why I encourage you all to make sure that you include your youth, be they nieces, nephews, children, grandchildren, include them in some educational pursuits as well, because the spark is there in the youth at this point. Many of us know, something that's been made light of, but how sometimes a child will just say, why? That's that curiosity in them to want to know. And I've always made it a point in my life to try to know, so that way if I'm asked a question, even if it's just in general, I have an idea. Because again, our community has been fooled so many times, as a guest that we had on the phone earlier said, through gentrification, we have lost so much because we did not know. And what was even worse is that we did not want to know. We didn't have that incentive, maybe the self-esteem, whatever it may have been, we just did not have those incentives, nor were we incentivized by our community to do those things. I see that we're at the top of the hour. If you want to, Brother Hines, you can hold on. We're going to take this FCC break, and we're going to have a video come on after that. It's called Urban Vibes, with yours truly as the main person in the video. And the video was designed to just, number one, show the different things that Detroit has. But again, as I said earlier, sometimes we have to teach our people through music, through plays, through movies, in order to get our message across, because sometimes just verbal communication doesn't work. So I want everyone to hold tight. Enjoy the video right after the break, and I will see you after the break.
In the world of digital broadcasting, transmitters and exciters sometimes do this. If this happens when you're watching WHPR TV 33, please do this. Watch us on Fire Stick, Roku, Apple TV, Google TV, or TV33WHPR.com. Download the WHPR TV app, and we can also be heard on Amazon Echo. So remember, if you see this, you can do this, and support the station that supports you.
Let's savor these moments, made possible by the COVID-19 vaccine. Dining out going by keeping yourself protected and your COVID-19 vaccines up to date.
I'm Wayne County Treasurer Eric Sabree. We are living through unprecedented times with a global pandemic now approaching its third year. As a result, the Michigan Homeowner Assistance Fund was created. This fund, administered by the state of Michigan, is designed to help homeowners cope with pandemic-related hardships, such as delinquent property taxes. To see if you qualify, please visit. Call 313-388-9799 or email taxinfo@waynecounty.com. We're here to help.
You're watching WHPS, Highland Park, Detroit.
WGPR Detroit, HD2.
Rock Solid Entertainment.
Thank you.
Jones, what's up?
Just chilling, man. We cooling back.
What we gonna get off into?
I can't call it.
Maybe pizza?
I'm a ride here chicken butt and video game.
Man, it's Saturday. It's nice out here, man.
What's up?
While we go downtown, there's always something nice going on. Is y'all with me, fellas?
Yeah, right on.
Right on.
Everybody, on your feet. Come on, come on. It's time to hit the streets. Yeah. Everybody, on your feet. Come on, come on. It's time to hit the streets, ladies.
Sound sense, grabbing people, filling the street, feeling the beat. Summer heat, sundresses with pretty feet. Women in sandals, heels, flip flops. Most on a mission, shot to drop. Come on, come on, come on, give them their props. Y'all already know they don't stop. Me and the crew mixing it with the multitude. Spirit of gratitude, no one with an attitude. Everybody's downtown having fun, and under the skin, we all one. Riders out cruising, babies rolling, the stroller snoozing. Whatever you want, it's here for the choosing. Living life in real time under no illusion. Sidewalk, bars, cafes, restaurants, some low key, others got to flaunt. Come on, come on, give it all you got. Y'all already know the city is hot. What I tell y'all?
Man, that's what's up, man.
Let's put this city on blast.
With you brothers to be your brother number two.
All right, y'all ready? Let's get in the mix.
Right on.
Sirens, voices, horn, feel the air. Easy to get lost in the atmosphere. You heard the horns blow. I hope you're ready to go. The best advice I can give, live life slow. Love, laugh, grow. Are you feeling my flow? Come on, come on. Y'all already know. The city streets on blast. Problems a thing of the past. Live each day as though it were your last. In the heart of the city, let your hair down. Open spaces, happy faces, men wearing a frown. Artists sketching, street musicians. One tribe, one vibe, no partitions. Elvis chilling on benches, children deep in the trenches. Pretty women turn heads like wrenches. Fireworks by the water, under a full moon. Hard castle got you rocking while I bless the tune.
Welcome back, and I hope you all enjoyed that video, and the lady that you saw at the end of the video was my wife who passed away. It'll be 11 years ago. This August 11th, as a matter of fact.
And you're so watching Detroit's own WHPR TV.
Also, I'd like to let you know that if I've done maybe close to 15 videos, and most of them have more of a social consciousness context to them. The video you just saw was a little bit more lighthearted because we, you know, summer only lasts so long, and we miss it for so long once it's gone. So it's important for us to be able to make the most of, get the fresh air. I hope that some of you had a chance this past weekend. Well, not this past weekend, the weekend before, to go to the African World Festival. I had a great time down there. I ran into some wonderful people, Brother Luther Keith, who many of you know from Arise Detroit, and also is Luther Badman Keith, the guitarist, blues guitarist. Shout out to Lori Parks. Saw her out there, and she's very much an activist in every sense of the word. Shout out to the sister. Also, was able to see a Brother Effie, who's from the motherland. Him and I matriculated together at the University of Detroit. And it was just a beautiful thing to be able to see our people engaged in a cultural experience, nothing but beauty and harmony, nice music. We're down by the riverfront. This was the first time it's been at Hart Plaza in so many years. And just to see all the different artwork, whether it be statues, matter of fact, some of the things that I have on here are part of what I picked up from there. We have to support our own businesses, and we have to support our culture. As I've heard said many times before, and I agree, there's a hardware that I go to on 7 Mile, which is black owned. There's a uniform shop, which is on Schaefer near 7 Mile, which I go to. And the thing is that if we don't support black businesses, who will? We know people in other communities are not coming to our businesses to shop. I mean, that's just a matter of fact. When we go in there, we're just going to see us. And if it's somebody else from another community, that is a random visit. So we already know that. If we don't take care of our community and our businesses, our school, the environment in which we live in, then that environment will not be able to sustain itself. And then that's where gentrification comes in. And when it comes in, they're moving us out. So I encourage you to support black businesses, seek black businesses, and help them, which also helps the community as well, because they're going to hire people within the community to run those businesses, to be a part of the workforce. Another thing that I would suggest, and this is all critical to me, we have 7 principles of Kwanzaa, okay? And we generally celebrate them from the 26th of December to the 1st of January, the Nguzo Sabo, the 7 principles of Kwanzaa. And the one that I'm always pushing the most of all is Ujamaa, which is cooperative economics, which means we spend money in our communities and we build our communities. It's been said, and it's still been sustained, that out of every dollar that we have, only a nickel of it stays in our community. The other 95% goes to other communities, whether it's the malls, they might be at Novi, might be at Oakland Mall, Dearborn, whatever. So we're building communities for others, but we're not building communities for ourselves. So I would like to just say that it's important for us. It's imperative. It's almost mandatory that we support our businesses, cooperative economics, us working together. That is the one principle of Kwanzaa that I will always push and maintain. And I've got my children and my granddaughter. She's 13 now, but I make it a point to emphasize this to her so that she can understand. If we get our children involved at an early age, plant those seeds, let them know what their responsibility is to community, and help them to understand their place in this society. Build that self-esteem within them. Keith, I want to get back to you, brother, but I had to, you know, get on my soapbox there for a minute. And just try to, you know, beat the drums like as we did in the motherland. Communicate. So, brother,
yeah,
Keith,
I'm proud of you, brother,
because as you mentioned when we first start our conversation, started our conversation, that you're involved in so many different things. So, and of course, again, we know that elections are coming up, and it's just important to become involved. We can't be spectators. Living as a citizen in this country and in this world, this is not a spectator sport where we sit back and view what's going on. You have to be a participant in it. No, I take that back. You don't have to be. You don't have to be anything. You don't have to do anything with your life, really, if you don't want to. But except it would be important if you did. We do have a caller that's calling in, and I want to see if this is the other caller we were expecting. Hello, caller. You're on the air. Would you share your name and how you're viewing us, please? Okay, let me do this. Hello, caller. You're on the air. Would you share your name and how you're viewing us, please? Now, what I may end up having to do is go back to Wayne County Community College, which is free for everyone 60 and over, so I can get my act together because technology is running faster than those of us who are elders can. Caller, do I have you on the air?
This is James Ford from the Obama Weekend. Can you hear me?
Oh, Brother Ford, welcome to the program. Shout out to Brother James Ford, Obama Weekend. Share with us, brother, all the information for the forthcoming Obama Weekend, how people can become involved, contact information, everything they need to know, because this, again, is another worthy thing that we have to do as a community of people, African Americans. This is on us. It's not on anyone else. Go ahead, Brother Ford.
Yeah, this is very important. 3 days. We're just going to try to promote and relive the legacy of President Barack Obama. And it's something that's very important. It'd be a tragedy and an atrocity if we let his legacy go down, because he was a person that dignity, integrity, and character. But I'm going to make this real quick. We're having a festival over at the Barack Obama Academy. August 5, 6, 7, and we need vendors. The festival is going to have karaoke, it's going to have song, dance, music, open mic, presentations from different proactive groups, and we're just trying to celebrate and have a good time. Now, this affair is very, very good because it's going to give a chance for all groups, all races, all nationalities to get together. It's a time for what we would call just comfort between the minds and the thinking. So August 5, 6, 7 at the Barack Obama Academy. We need vendors. My phone number is 586-918-3061. It's going to be a great event, a great affair. You can call me if you want to be a vendor. Take part. 586-918-3061.
And I want to encourage everyone to become a part of it, because I am wholeheartedly in support of Brother James Ford, and especially the idea that we cannot let the first black president become obscure. His exemplary behavior is a role model for us all. And we have to keep in mind that when he ran in 2008 and again in 2012, that he was able to incorporate, as Mr. Ford has said, he brought together people of all ethnicities and races together, which is why he was successful. So I think it's very important for us to not let his name go into obscurity and keep it alive. And the Obama Weekend is for that. So again, brother, if you give us maybe the address of the Obama Academy as well, as the phone number and the dates.
10800 East Canfield, 10800 East Canfield in Detroit. And my phone number is 586-918-3061. And I'm going to add one other thing that I want people to think about. The Obama Weekend is not so much about Barack Obama, although we are going to celebrate it, but it's about the next Barack Obama. We're going to focus on him. Children, emulate who you celebrate. So we're going to celebrate him, and we may get another Barack Obama, because the next Barack Obama may be at home crawling around. He may be in the back seat of your car, or he could be looking in your refrigerator now, right now. This is James Ford from the Obama Weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate your call. want to let our engineer know that we have someone at the door. But I want to encourage you all, and I'm going to give you Brother James Ford's telephone number again. Again, he needs vendors. You can contact James Ford at area code 586-918-3061. Again, that's 586 area code 918-3061. And one of the things I want to mention is this is interactive for all ages. The children will have programs every day, August 5th through 7th. There will be programs where the children will be involved, but it's interactive on every age level. And as James Ford said, one of the things that's involved also is that it, as he says, the next Barack Obama might be in the looking through your refrigerator, riding in the car seat behind the riding in the car seat with you or in the crib, but we don't know who we're introducing and bringing into the fold. So again, I want to be able to encourage you all to have your family participating. It's a three-day event, and similar to the African World Festival, if you can make any one of the 3 days. Now, those of you who have different creative art, you know, vendors, you may have food, you may have jewelry, artwork, et cetera, that you want to sell, this would be a perfect forum for that. So, I want to give you the phone number. I'm going to give you the address and the date. I'll say it slowly. The phone number for James Ford is 586-918-3061. The Barack Obama Academy is located at 10800 East Canfield. Again, that's 10800 East Canfield, and that's going to be August 5th through the 7th. So it's upcoming. Put it on your calendar. As I say, you want to involve your children, your grandchildren, your family. It's a cultural experience. It's an experience that many and all of you can benefit from. You know, YouTube's going to be there. TikTok's going to be there. Facebook's going to be there. But at this Barack Obama weekend, you should be there. So I hope that you'll be there. Now, I want to let you also know about the Hastings Street. I'm just kind of let you see this as I speak about it. And I just put my glasses on. That's what age does for you. Okay, it's a new musical about our city. Plowshares Theater presents Hastings Street. The world premiere musical is set on the cusp of change in Detroit in the summer of 1949. Detroit is electric with anticipation. President Truman has just signed into law the Housing Act, ushering a nationwide urban renewal initiative. Detroit city planners have earmarked Black Bottom, which I grew up in, the nickname for the segregated Black neighborhood, as the target for most of its urban redevelopment projects. Sporting a book and score written by local artists, and earlier you heard us interviewing Brother John Sloan III, who was responsible for the overwhelming task of putting this together along with Chris Johnson. Hastings Street follows the Carson family as they navigate being uprooted on a personal and communal basis. Hastings Street is an original musical commissioned by Plowshares Theater Company. Gary Anderson is the producing director. Now, if you want to get the contact information, you can call, and I'll read this a couple of times slowly for you. Area code 313-887-8500. Again, for more information, you can call 313-887-8500. If you want to buy your tickets online, you can go to www.musichall.org. Music Hall is all one word. Again, that's www.musichall.org. And I really encourage you to see this because we're dealing with gentrification now. I'll just kind of let you all be able to see this. We're dealing with gentrification now. And the problem with that is that whatever we've had, and this has happened nationwide, when they got into urban development, which was basically urban removal, they would make sure that they built their highways through the black community, destroying black community. Now, we had Black Wall Street at one time, as many of you know, in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Greenwood. And the jealousy of the so-called dominant or majority population decided that we were doing too good. Now, I'm a product of Black Bottom myself, just before all that stuff happened. And I remember, even as a child, some of the things that were going on. So I think this musical about Hastings Street, and many of you viewers are my age and maybe a little younger, but even no matter what your age is, we need to understand part of our roots, particularly those who are Detroiters, understand part of our roots and what we had and what we've lost. Now, many of you know of Black Bottom, and some of you have heard of Paradise Valley. If you haven't, then when you start Googling and YouTube, do that, because as I say, we tend to Google for or YouTube for information, entertainment more than anything else. You know, what is Nicki Minaj doing? What is Future Ludacris doing? Well, it's ludicrous for us not to pursue our community, to understand our history and to understand our culture and to build. So again, let me get these glasses on because I want to make sure that I read everything correctly. The musical is from July 21st through July 31st at the Music Hall. The title is Hastings Street. Now, for tickets, you can go to www.musichall.org. Again, that's www.musichall.org. Or for more information, you can call 313-887-8500. Again, that's 313-887-8500. And as Mr. Sloan said when he and I were in the interview, even though it's the uprooting of a family, the Carson family, it's a musical as well. So there's a variety of different experiences that you will have. So I like the whole historical foundation of it, of how a family had to adjust their life with the impending urban development. And it's interesting how this country uses so many different code words, buzzwords, but they don't tell the truth. They just kind of, they put icing on a rotten cake and then have us ready to consume that. Hastings Street will be a revelation of sorts. For those of you who are not part of Detroit, didn't grow up in Detroit, this may be foreign to you. Those of you who have grown up in Detroit may not be able to, because the schools are not teaching these things. We're going through gentrification now. Even in the Hastings Street area, I add this as a footnote, now they're talking about the 375 that came through that area and destroyed the black community. Now they're talking about trying to, I guess they're going to put up a little memorial plaque. You know how they do. They'll put up a little plaque saying, yeah, this used to be. And we can't deal what used to be. It's about us building, which is why I also mentioned the fact that cooperative economics. We had an economic stronghold. When Paradise Valley and Black Bottom existed, that was our community. We shop with each other. We work with each other. We live with each other. We help to build each other. Our doctors, dentists, lawyers, along with just your regular blue-collar people, all of us lived in that community, and we worked together, and we were a community. There was no drama. The larger society decided they wanted to create a little drama, disrupt us, because they knew what our potential was, and I say what our potential is as well. So when I speak about cooperative economics, and I think that this is, as this is a premiere, we want this to have a very good showing, and then we want this to be able to go across the country and maybe even across the world. But we start here. This is where our roots are at. So I'm encouraging everyone to become a part of the Hastings Street experience, which will be at Music Hall, and it's also involving Plowshares, which has been around forever, ever since I would say in the 70s when I was pursuing academic goals. I have heard of Plowshares, and it's been around. This is another wonderful institution within our community, and I just think it's important for us to be able to support our community. It's mandatory. I'll just say this. I don't know if you're going to be there, if I'll see you in the audience, but if you're there, you're going to see me in the audience. We have a 10-day, I would say 10-day window that we're going to be able to enjoy this. And bring your family. If you got elders, seniors, bring them because they were part of that disruption of our community. If you have youth, then let them have an experience with what our community is. And the fact that we're dealing with a family, and as Mr. Sloan said, he said, yeah, it may seem a little depressing, you know, because we are looking at the uprooting of our community and the destruction of our community and culture. But because of all the other things that are involved in it, and he's had a hand in everything, set design, the musical, the writing of the play, so he's been very involved in this. And I'm going to be long-winded on purpose because I think it's just necessary for us to be able to know and to embrace this. So, again, I'll give you the information once again on how you can become a part of the experience. This is presented, Plowshares Theater is presenting Hastings Street, a world premiere musical on the cusp of change in Detroit in the summer of 1949. If you want to become a part of it, and I hope so, you can buy your tickets at www.musichall.org. Again, that's www.musichall.org. And if you want more information, you can contact 313-887-8500. Again, that's 313-887-8500. Group sales, you can call area code 313-887-8501. Again, for group sales, it's 313-887-8501. I hope that you'll all become a part of it. And as we close out the show, I want to give a shout out to Theo Broughton, who had another activity to attend. I want to give a shout out to Brother Mark Covings, and also Speak for the People. This is on July 30th from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Detroit City Airport, which is also known as the Coleman Young International Airport. Spoken word challenges. Participants should focus on positivity, voting, and issues that speak to you. Do better if you knew better. There will be cash prizes. Again, Speak for the People, July 30th from 3 to 6 p.m. at Detroit City Airport. A spoken word challenge. Participants should focus on positivity, voting, and issues that speak to you. Do better if you knew better. And it's sponsored by Hood Research. So I hope that you'll be there. I'm a spoken word artist too, so you know I'm down with that all the way. And as we close out on every show, what I'll do is say Theo's little thing, which is you don't have to know everything, but what you do have to know is how to find what you need when you need it. And that's what Hood Research seeks to do. And my closing statement is always, if you want to be nothing, do nothing. But the only problem with doing nothing is you never know when you're finished. And I want to thank Brother Keith Hines for holding it down with me and say to the audience, peace.
Feedback.
Hi, this is Theo Broughton.
And I am the BDM Pinda.
Inviting you to join us each Monday at 9 a.m. for Feedback.
A positive image production by Hood Research.
Encourage others to tune in each Monday on
Comcast Detroit, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, watch WHPR TV Network anywhere.
And take us along with you.
Feedback.